Hello there, and welcome to lesson number 2 in our series on descriptive geometry. Today we're going to talk about creating auxiliary views and completing visibility in those views. Now before we get started with that, I want to let you know that I know that last time, in the first video, I made this really fancy glass box that unfolded and you could see really easily which view was which. From this point forward in the series, I'm not going to be drawing those glass boxes around every three-dimensional object, but that doesn't mean that you shouldn't be trying to visualize the glass box containing the object we're trying to draw, and imagine how the object might look if you were looking through a particular view of that glass box. With time and practice, I have the fullest confidence that your 3D visualization skills are going to improve. But it's not going to improve that quickly if I keep drawing the glass box. So for that reason, it's not going to appear again. Now, let's move on to today's subject, which is auxiliary views. Now, an auxiliary view is a view of an object that isn't one of the six kind of standard planar views. An example of one of those planar views might be, here's the front plane of the object, maybe the right plane of the object, or a top view. These are all standard profile views of the object. An auxiliary view might be, say if we wanted to look at this inclined plane right here, and I look normal to that, this would be considered an auxiliary view, because it's not a view that I can get by any one of the six standard views. I have to kind of make a custom view of that in order to talk about something that I may be interested in, or something I might want to know information about. Now, the question is, how do we go about making auxiliary views in AutoCAD? And the way we do that is through something that you're going to hear quite a lot when you're studying descriptive geometry. It's called measuring things two views back. Now, what we mean by two views back is that every view of the object only gives you a limited amount of information to describe the object. In this view, you only have two-thirds of the necessary information to describe this object. You have information in the y-axis, on the y-axis, which would be like the heights of things, or you have information along the x-axis, which would be the width of things, but you don't know anything about depth. For instance, you don't know if this surface is closer to me or farther away than this surface right here. You can't tell. They look the same. So in order to figure out new information, such as the depth, we're going to have to change our view. So we'll do that by looking at the right side. Aha! Now we can tell that this side is closer to us than this side was. And we retain information about the height. We can still pick up, you know, this height to here to here, this height from here to here. That's the same information. But in exchange, we've lost information about the width of the object. For instance, this point right here. You can't tell me if it's closer or farther away from me than this point right here. So in order to figure that out, we'll just continue turning the part around the y-axis. And if we do, we're back to having information about the y and x-axis, which is what we started with to begin with. Notice that they're like reverse orientation. Originally the x-axis pointed this way, now it's pointed to the left over here. But that's not necessarily a big deal. The larger point is this. Every other view contains the same information. Let's go back and do it really quickly. If we look at the front of the object, I start with information about the y and x axis, and then one view, two views later, I still have information about the y and x axis. If I go, say, this way, I end up with information about the x and y axes. And if I go this way, I still end up with information about the x and y axes. To hammer that point home, to really rigidly get a good idea, imagine this blue line, this window through which we're looking at the object. If we were to measure from here to, say, that surface, and then here to that surface, right here, and maybe a third measurement from here to that surface over there. And then I was to turn the object around 180 degrees. Well, that measurement from here to here would be the same as before, and this measurement would be the same from here to here, and this measurement from here to here would also be the same. So every other view has an equivalent, you know, an equivalent distance away from the plane that you're measuring from. And that's what we mean. That's what they're talking about when they say measure things that are two views back, because it means you're rotating the object around 180 degrees. The measurements should be the same. Now, I know I've shown you with an example that only involves the primary views, but this rule is going to hold true for any auxiliary view, any craziness you can imagine, so long as you look two views back, and we're going to discuss what that means as we go through examples, then the measurements are always going to hold true. Let's take a look at our first example. We want to create an auxiliary view of this pyramid type shape, looking in the direction of this arrow that is labeled 1. So the first step in creating an auxiliary view is we need to draw some folding lines. Recall that folding lines represent the edges of a glass box which encapsulate this pyramid. Because we want to look, because we want to have a special view of this one right here, one of those folding lines needs to be perpendicular to the arrow that specifies the direction that you're looking through it. So, let's draw that line first. I'm going to open up the line command. I'm going to make sure that my perpendicular O snap is on. If it's not, you can find it right there. And I'll pick a point, zoom in, and there's a perpendicular snap. I'll pick up the whole line by clicking on this middle blue dot right there and move the line up. And we are done with that arrow, so we're going to delete it. We need to make one more folding line, so I'm going to turn on the orthogonal restriction right there. And I'm going to draw a horizontal button, or a horizontal folding line, rather. The next thing that we need to do is we need to label these folding lines, so I'm going to click on any one of the letters, and I'm going to decide to copy it. I'm going to drag it really close to this folding line here, almost just right there and right there. I'm going to relabel them. This side of the folding line corresponds to the horizontal side, because there's a that's the horizontal point V right there. And this side down here corresponds to the frontal view, so we'll replace that X with a frontal view, or an F for frontal. Drag that guy down so they're a little bit apart, spaced just a little bit away from the folding line. And then we'll copy those guys and drag them over to the other folding line here. Highlight again. And then rotate them roughly so that they're lined up nicely with, you know, nicely with the folding line. Again, this side over here, the closest side, this is to the horizontal view, so we'll leave that as an H, but this side over here, that was going to be auxiliary view 1, so we'll replace it with a 1. The next thing that we need to do is we need to make projection lines. So we're going to switch the layer that we're talking about. So we go to the layers, I'll switch to construction geometry, I'll open up the line command, and from the point X, after I turn on my snaps again, we'll draw a point that a line that is perpendicular to the folding line. Then we'll take that line, we'll copy it, we'll give one to each point in the drawing. Then I'm going to open up the lengthen command by typing len. I'll type dy for dynamic, and what that allows me to do is that allows me to grab the end of the points and just kind of scooch them out. It doesn't have to be very precise or anything. We're really just making room. Now, this bar right here, this is where the actual auxiliary view is going to happen, and if you look over here in SOLIDWORKS, you can see that we have that same top-down view of the pyramid, and we have a blue line here that looks to be in the same orientation as our folding line. if we rotate this model down, you can see that that blue line actually represents a plane right here, and that's the view that we're looking through to see the pyramid behind it. So let's return that back to the top view. The next step when making an auxiliary view is we're going to offset, but what do we offset into where? And this is where that whole two views back thing comes from. We're going to measure from this view, we're going to one view, and we're going to jump back by one view, that's one view there, and then two views. So, view that I'm interested in, one view, two view. So, when we measure, what we're going to do is we're going to measure from this point to this horizontal folding line, and then we're going to offset this in this direction. We're going to take this folding line and move it this direction. And those distances, this distance from here to point WZ, should be the same as this point to WZ. This line to V should be the same distance as this line to the point V. Let's see how it works out. I'll type offset, use the offset command, and then I will directly click on the point WZ to a parallel snap right there. I'll move it over. Boom. Now, using my projection lines, I'm going to look at the point W, since that's one of the points that got projected. So I'm going to write W all the way down to that point of intersection right there. And right where that point of intersection happens, I'm going to drop just a very small circle. There's also another point right there, point Z. So we'll track Z down to that intersection right there. And right where that intersection happens, we'll drop a circle. The next thing we'll do, we'll open up the offset command again, and we will specify point V to the folding line, and then from the folding line, we'll offset again. This time we're talking about point V, so we'll track point V through. That intersection right there is going to get a circle. That's going to be point V. And we'll delete that. Then we'll do it one more time. Offset from the point XY, and then offset. Well, that's interesting. See how the offset folding line almost, it passes right through those two circles that represent the point W and Z? Well, it makes sense that these guys would have the same distance away from the folding line because these two lines are parallel to each other. This distance has to be the same as this distance, has to be the same as this distance, which also means that the distance from the folding line to Y and the folding line to X also have to be on that same offset line. So we'll add two more circles. One for the point X, one for the point Y. And we'll delete that. The next thing that we're going to do, we're going to change layers. We're going to move to the object layer. And I'm going to draw lines that connect everything. Usually when I'm drawing object lines that connect things, I'm looking at what point I'm starting from. So I'm thinking about point V, this is point V, and point V is connected to point X, point Y, point W, and point Z. So there it's connected to X, there it's connected to W, there it's connected to Y, and here connected to Z. You'll also notice from point X is connected to V, that's already taken care of. X is connected to Y, which is that point right there. And X is also connected to W, which is right there. We could go around every point and do that, but what we end up finding out is these four individual lines from this perspective looking in would look like one single object line. So that's what we'll do. We'll draw an object line connecting these points right here. The next step, we'll take the projection lines, and we'll put them right at the intersections. Grab that intersection, move it in there, right there. Take that intersection, move it to there. This intersection, move it to here. this projection line to that intersection right there. And at this point, I'm going to remove the little circles. They're not actually necessary. They just help us keep track of where points were in space without having to have too many offset lines. Our next task is to label points. So what I'll do is I'll go ahead and copy this little x value here. And I'll place a letter right where every point should be. I'm going to copy this guy right here. Place it right there, reasonably close to wherever that point is. Make sure that they match up. X should go to X. W should go to W. Y should go to Y. And Z should go to Z. The only thing that's left to do is adjust the superscript on the point V. So I'll go ahead and delete the H, one and a caret. Highlight these two things because this is a multi-text note, not a single text note. And I can add a one. So now you can track that point V through all the views. This is the frontal view of the point V, the horizontal view of point V, and the auxiliary view number one of point V. So this is almost completed. One last thing to do, or two last things to do. The next thing to do is to shorten the projection lines, because projection lines don't actually touch these points of interest, these connected points between these two views. So what we'll do is we'll type LEN for length, and then we'll type in DE for delta. We'll type in minus 3 for our change, because I want the line to be a little bit shorter, so I put a minus in front. And I'll click right next to the line and see how the line shortens away from that guy. You can think of projection lines almost like vectors. It's almost like they point. Each of these guys is almost like it's pointing at one of these points right here. It's pointing towards W. We'll come over here. We'll do the same thing over here really quickly. Nice and fast. There we go. Now, there's one last thing to do. We need to talk about the visibility. If you were to think about this, if you were looking at this pyramid from this direction, pretend your eye was this way, right? You'd see this as a hard edge, right? You'd see this as a hard edge. You'd see this as a hard edge. But what about that line right there, which corresponds to VW, which corresponds to VW right here? Well, you wouldn't be able to actually see that because your eye would be passing through this material right here. And you wouldn't actually see that hard edge right there, which means that can't be an object line. So we'll go back to our layers, and we'll turn that into a hidden line, which indicates that it's behind the material. And this is a completed auxiliary view of the pyramid. Let's go to SOLIDWORKS and see what SOLIDWORKS says. So I'll bring the view. I'll bring custom auxiliary view 1. Not too shabby. It almost looks right. Let's turn on hidden line shown. Awesome. You can see perfect. One nice big line right along here. You can see that hidden line right there. You can see the outline. Looks exactly like AutoCAD predicted it would look. I don't know about you. That's pretty cool. If we turn this guy back into a solid, move this guy around, you can see right there, that's your hidden line. And it corresponds to the same exact line that we said it would be right there. In our next example, we're going to be building a right side profile view of a tetrahedron, which is a pyramid-like shape. For this example, I made a SOLIDWORKS model, but it does practically nothing to help with visualizing what's going on. So for this example, we're going to be working without a 3D model. But the process is going to be the same. It's the same as before. The first thing we're going to deal with is we're going to deal with these little blue lines right here. And these little lines right here is the textbook's way of telling us that there should be a line right here, but there's going to be some visibility that you're going to have to figure out, so we're just not going to draw those lines in. So the first thing we'll do is we're just going to delete all of those. they really do nothing for us. Let's make sure we're on the object layer. And I'll draw a line from A to C. And then I'll draw a line from B to D. Again, I'll draw a line from A to C. And then a line from B to D. Now, really quickly, I'm going to jump to the viewport layer. And I'm going to draw a straight vertical red line. That. The reason I'm doing that is because we need to determine the visibility of these two lines. They cross, and they're in the middle of the object. So that means that one of these lines is closer to our view, and one of them's farther away. But you can't tell which one is which. So in order to determine the visibility between the line AC and BD, we're going to look at the intersection in an adjacent view, and then we're going to trace this line, and we're going to see which of the two lines in question we cross first. So we have a conflict between line AC and line BD. I start tracing upward. First line I cross is BC. That's not one of the two lines I'm looking for. The next line I cross is right there, and it's AC. Well, that means that AC here is in the front, which means that BD is in the back, so we'll move the line BD to a hidden line layer. We'll run the process again, this time setting our reference line to be at the intersection of AC and BD, just as before, and we'll start again. Moving into the adjacent view, the first line we cross is AD. The next line we cross is AC. Well, that means that this line AC has to be in front. It means that BD has to be in back, so we'll move BD to the hidden line layer. There you go. Now the visibility for both the horizontal and front views has been completed. You can kind of see now how this thing looks more like a pyramid. And now we're going to construct a right side view over here. The first step, as always, is to draw our folding lines, and this problem has decided to be really nice for us and include the folding lines and their designations. So we're going to skip right to step two. We're going to turn on the construction layer, and we're going to draw a straight line right across from point D. We'll take that line, copy it, I'll type LEN for length, DY for dynamic, and I will make all of these lines be just about approximately the same length. Now, this is where our view is going to go. So in order to figure out where we're measuring from, we'll go two views back. One view back, two view back. So here's where we're going to be measuring from. Let's work alphabetically this time. It seems like a good idea. We'll go A, B, C, then D. So let's open up the offset command. We'll offset point A to the nearest folding line. We'll take this folding line and offset. We offset point A, so we'll trace point A all the way through. There's that intersection, which means that's a point right there. Close that guy out. We'll rerun the same process for point B. Trace point B all the way through, and there we go, there's point B. Again, for point C, to the hidden line, offsets. It was a circle, trace point C all the way through, right there, there's point C. One last time, point D, right to there. Right to there. Point D, moving all the way through to here. Alright, now let's move to the object layer. I don't know why that popped up. There we go. Now we're on the object layer. And the next thing we're going to do is we're going to connect all the points that are connected. So point A, which would be that point right there, is connected to point D. So we'll connect points A and D. Point A is also connected to point C, which is that guy right there. So A to C. Point A is connected to point B. And looks like that's all point A is connected to, D, C, and B. Okay, we'll move to point B. Point B is connected to point A. That's definitely true, we just did that one. Point B is connected to point C. There's point B connected to point C. Point B is also connected to point D. So we'll connect points B and D together. Let's see. Looks like that's everything there. Point C is connected to point A. We already know that's true. Point C is connected to point B. We know that's true. Point C is connected to point D, which we don't have yet. So point C will be connected to point D. And then point D is connected to points A, C, and B, which it should be. A, C, and B. Great. Now we'll take the projection lines and we'll shorten them up so they only talk to the point they point to the point that they're supposed to be linked to. That's looking a lot cleaner right there, right there. Time to copy some letters, so we'll select C just for copying. Give everybody a letter here. Here, here, and here. Point A gets its own little copy. And there's A over there. This superscript on that guy will become a P. This guy is point D. This guy is point C, so we're good there. This guy should be point B. We'll erase this guy. All the circles are erased. We will now decide about the visibility between the conflict of these two lines, A to C and B to D. So let's go ahead and draw that red line. We'll draw it right at that intersection right there. And you don't have to do this if you can see, if you can track it in your mind without need of an aid, that's great. I'm going to do this probably the first 10 times or so that we do it, and then we'll just slowly ease that crutch out for us. So as we're moving along here, first line I intersect is BC. It's not one of the lines I'm looking for. Next line I intersect looks like B to D, which means that B to D is in front. So this guy's in front. That means that this guy is behind. We'll move that to the hidden line layer. We will delete our little reference line there that helped us with the visibility. We'll type LEN for length, DE for delta. We'll type in -3 since I want to shorten the projection lines away from the points that they should be pointing at. There you go, there's that, B, and then over here, same deal. And there you go. This is a completed profile view of the tetrahedron, and it includes the visibility. You can see how the visibility is changing. Here, B to D was behind, it's still behind. All of a sudden, it pops into the front. You can see how the visibility is changing also for AC is doing the opposite effect. So this completes the problem. This is your answer right here. That's the right profile view of this particular tetrahedron. Notice how the procedure didn't change at all. Again, all we did was we made folding lines, label the folding lines, draw projection lines, we counted two views back, we measured, we had a system for how we went about it. In our case, we went alphabetically, A, B, C, D. Then we did those offsets, picked up the lines, we connected the dots, and then we looked for visibility, and then cleaned everything up. Every time you make an auxiliary view, it's going to be the same procedure. For our last example today, we're going to look at the visibility between two non-intersecting bars, this bar A to B and this bar P to Q. Now, I've made a SOLIDWORKS model for us right here for this one, and it's pretty easy to tell which bar's in front. And it's pretty obvious the red bar's in front because the color's not interrupted, right? There's two options. So one of the options is either the red bar is closest to us, or it's farther away from us. But if I turn on the wireframe view, you can't actually tell the difference between option one and option two. They look exactly the same. So now how do you determine the visibility? How do you determine which one's closest to you and which one's not closest to you? What's nice is that you already know the answer. We've been doing this technique for a little bit. when we determine visibility, we draw a line through the intersection, and then we continue up into another view, and whichever object the reference line passes through first is we consider to be the closest to us in the view that we're investigating. So why exactly does that work the way it does? Let's turn the model back to color in SOLIDWORKS, and we'll take a look to the side here. I've opened up a sketch so that you can see that there's a line right here that we draw, and then this line takes a right turn as it's folding over the glass box that encloses these two bars. And you can see that if we unfolded that glass box, it would look like a straight line, just like that. And that's what we're drawing. That's what we're referencing in AutoCAD when we draw this the way we do. So let's look back at the top here. So that's what that line represents. And then if we shift our view up, you'll notice that that line, the first thing that it crosses is the red bar. And that's exactly what you said when we started this example, was that the red bar was forward. That's obvious. We'll return back to option two. We'll just put the gray bar just in front, just for kicks. And we'll do the same thing. You'll notice that even though the gray bar is in front, when we draw the line the same way, the line always passes through the thing that's closest to our view, always. So that's why the visibility rule works the way it does. So let's try that out in AutoCAD. So here we go. I'm going to make a reference line. I can pick either of the intersections here. I could pick this intersection, or I could pick this intersection. Doesn't really matter. The information should be the same, no matter what. So we come up, and the first thing we cross is the rod A to B, which means this rod right here, A to B, is going to be in front of the rod P to Q. Just like that. Which means that this rod right here, since P to Q is behind rod A to B, that means we need some hidden lines right there. Couple hidden lines right there. To scooch those object lines right up, because when we look straight in, we wouldn't see a hidden line away from the object. It would be almost like we saw a hidden line, a portion of this guy is a hidden line, which is not true. So we have to do a little bit of adjusting. We don't even need that reference line anymore. And there we go. There's the visibility of the two rods. Now, we can check that by drawing another reference line. For this intersection right here, the first thing we pass is P to Q, which means in this view, P to Q has to be in front, closest to our eye. So we'll take P to Q and we'll complete this object line right there. This object line right there. This guy with some hidden lines. It's the same process. And there you go. That's the completed visibility of these two non-intersecting rods. So that's why the procedure that we've developed in the previous examples works. Whenever you want to test the visibility, you look at the intersection of two things, you trace a straight line back into a previous view, and whichever thing you cross first, that's the thing that's in front. The other thing has to be behind it. It's that simple. All right, that's going to do it for us for lesson two. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.